professor. Before Fukushima, what are the possibilities, both, you know, good and bad?
Well, you know, nuclear energy had so much promise decades ago. Many futurists predicted that by the year 2000, we would have 1,000 reactors and 1,000 breeder reactors in the United States.
Right.
Now we're lucky to just have 100 ordinary reactors, and we have zero breeder reactors. So there's been a collapse of nuclear energy in the United States. However, in Japan, we have something even worse. Right now, we have this raging meltdown that's in a temporary stasis. Right now, every single nuclear power plant in Japan is shut down. Every single one. Zero energy output from nuclear energy right
wow.
now.
Wow.
So it's causing a national crisis. You know, that's the third largest economy on the planet. And all of a sudden, one of their main sources of energy is shut off. So it's caused a tremendous amount of disruption. And the cleanup will take about 40 years. 40 years. Chernobyl, by the way, back in 1986, it's still going on. You realize the core is still melting its way through the earth in outside Kiev. And that's been, 25 years in the making. So it'll take about 40 years to clean up the Fukushima disaster.
All right. On behalf of my wife and others, I want to ask this. When Fukushima happened, I was in the Philippines, you know, and we were worried to death. Oh, the radiation's going to come this way. Of course, it went toward the U.S. instead, because that's where the prevailing winds, I guess, take it. Now, here's my question. They're pouring all of this water on the reactors to keep them from further, I guess, meltdown. And this water is running off. They're trying to capture it as best they can. But they're not doing a really good job. A lot of it's leaking into the Pacific Ocean.
That's yes? right. TEPCO, the utility, has now admitted that they bungled the cleanup operation. 300 tons worth of radioactive water, we think, have spilled into the outside environment and probably into the Pacific Ocean.
Right.
The Korean government is now threatening not to purchase any more fish from Japan because of this crisis. This is going to escalate as a consequence of this. And TEPCO, unfortunately, is sort of like, you know, the Three Stooges operating a nuclear power plant. Mo, Larry, and Curly chasing each other around the control room, hitting each other over the head. We have a bunch of incompetents running that nuclear power plant. I think that eventually the government's going to have to take over and do what Gorbachev did back in 1986, and that is call out the military. It was a military operation that finally got the Chernobyl under control. And I think the Japanese government may have to do something similar, admit that the utility is totally outclassed, outgunned, and they should perhaps bring in the military.
Wow. Self-defense forces or U.S. military?
Self-defense forces. You realize
can
that
they handle
Chernobyl,
it?
A quarter of a million people were involved in that cleanup operation. A quarter
right.
of a million people. It was the largest engineering feat of its type ever.
And a lot of them died. A lot of them died, too, right?
The firemen and the initial emergency crews, yeah, they died a horrible, horrible death. You know, skin falling off, hair falling off. They had a lethal dose of radiation in the initial day of the Chernobyl accident, yeah.
So is that what they're facing in Japan? I mean, are there some jobs that are so damn dangerous that if they start a real cleanup and send in the military, there's going to be people that will not live through the experience?
Chernobyl, many people were sent in just for a few minutes, to do these very important tasks. Robots, for example, cannot do these tasks. No matter how many science fiction movies we've seen with robots in them, robots can barely turn a screwdriver. And so robots have been a total failure at Fukushima. And as a consequence, the Pentagon, the U.S. Pentagon, has now set up a crash program to develop robots that can actually turn screws and turn valves. And
robots have been a giant failure worldwide anyway. I mean, when I was a kid, we all thought, oh, man, robots will be doing the dishes and cleaning the rugs and everything else by the time we're grown up.
Yeah, no, robots have the intelligence of an insect, like a cockroach, a retarded, lobotomized cockroach. They're very slow, the robots we have at MIT. Okay. And, you know, you put them inside Chernobyl, and all they do is get lost.
Can I just stop you for 1 second and ask why? Why have we not made more strides in robotics?
We made a mistake 50 years ago. We thought that the brain is a computer. But you see, the brain is not a digital computer. There's no Windows. There's no Pentium chip. There's no software. There's no programming. There's no subroutines. The brain is not a digital computer. It's a learning machine. It's called a neural network. It learns, and it changes itself after it learns, right? Now, your laptop today is just as stupid as it was yesterday, because laptops never change. They never learn anything. And that's the difference between a digital computer robot and a human brain. The brain does one thing, learn, okay? It doesn't compute. It doesn't add. It doesn't subtract like what ordinary robots do.
My Windows 7 does not learn.
Right. And, you know, robots are adding machines, very sophisticated. So it gives you the appearance that it's thinking, but it's actually not thinking at all. It's just adding.
Right.
While we are learning machines. And that's why at Fukushima, we have robots that can't even turn a screwdriver. That bad.
So they're no good. So are people going to lose their lives trying to get Fukushima under control eventually?
I hope it doesn't happen that way. But, you know, if they do what the Russians did, they'll order, you know, hundreds of thousands of people to go in just for a few minutes apiece and turn the screws and open the valves and begin the cleanup operation. Mm-hmm. You realize they keep dumping cold water on the reactor and it flows out because the loop is not closed. It's an open loop.
And
until they close the loop, they're going to dump more water and create more radioactive water as a consequence.
All right. What about the fish? What about the sea life? What about the ocean? You're an environmentalist as well as everything else. So how bad is it?
Well, that's what we're fearful of. You know, cesium, strontium, and iodine occur in water-soluble form. And they will eventually wind up into the food chain. In fact, even in Tokyo, some housewives bring Geiger counters when they go shopping. There are hot spots outside the evacuation zone of Fukushima, you know, because it rains and the radiation was distributed unevenly. There are hot spots. And as you get closer to Fukushima, there are dead zones, you know, areas that, just like at Chernobyl, will be off limits for centuries to come. And it does mean that we have to inspect the fish because strontium, iodine, cesium will accumulate in muscle tissue and different kinds of organs of the fish. So it is something that has to be monitored. So far, so good. So far, there has been no major dumping of radioactive waste. But, hey, it could happen. It's seeping slowly. But so far, we have not yet seen a catastrophic breach of the water.
Okay. Professor, if you were a one-man committee in charge of deciding what the world needs to do with nuclear power and nuclear power plants and where we go as a world from here for energy, what would your advice to the world be with respect to nuclear power?
Well, I think every country has to decide for itself, but the Germans have decided and they've thrown in the towel. Nuclear power is going to be phased out in Germany. Also, Switzerland, they both have phased out nuclear energy. Italy is teetering. Japan, every poll shows that the people do not want nuclear. But, of course, something has to replace it, right?
Yes.
And right now, there's no single white knight. We would like to go with solar and renewable technology and clean technology. But solar is more expensive, and we're going to have to reduce the cost of solar. Now, further down the line, I think maybe within 5 to 10 years, in that framework, solar power gets cheaper and cheaper and slowly becomes more competitive with oil and coal. But on a 10-year time frame, fusion becomes possible. The French are bidding the store on the ITER fusion reactor that will hopefully go online in 10 years or so.
It'll be safe?
Well, we don't know because we've never had an operating fusion reactor before, but fusion reactors do not melt down. Meltdowns are caused by nuclear waste. The heat emitted from nuclear waste causes meltdowns. While
let me try this. Yes, if a fusion reactor goes wrong, what do we have?
Well, nothing, because it shuts itself off.
Oh, good.
A fusion reactor has to attain what is called Lawson's criterion. Lots of the criteria, you have to have the right density, the right temperature to get fusion off the ground. The sun does it. Hydrogen bombs do it. And a fusion plant also has to attain lots of the criteria. But if you have a leak, then the lots of the criteria is no longer satisfied, and it shuts off. So the fusion plant basically shuts off. It doesn't melt like a conventional nuclear fission plant because it has no nuclear waste.
Dare I ask, so nothing can go wrong?
Well, there's always something that can go wrong, but not on the scale of fission. You know, fission reactors that use uranium are not found in nature. Mother Nature does not use uranium at all. Uranium is only found on the planet Earth for fission reactors. Mother Nature uses fusion, which is clean, recyclable. Right. That's what Mother Nature uses, fusion.
Well,